Thanks very much. It's a pleasure to be here today to talk to you a little bit about some of my research. I'm going to talk about my current and past work on colonialism and on anti-colonialism, and specifically on nationalism. And I'll begin by discussing a bit of my recent book, which I circulated a bit of to all of you. And that book looks at the causes of nationalist opposition to imperial rule. Today, the ability of nationalism to motivate resistance seems apparent. And we often hear about nationalist reactions in the news, whether we're hearing about Iraq or Afghanistan, or in studies of international war and ethnic conflict. And a lot of our thinking about nationalism and its power to mobilize comes from our impressions of the nationalist movements that overthrew colonial regimes. Nationalism in places like India and Vietnam and Algeria has shaped our views about the ability of nationalism to mobilize people, to motivate asymmetric conflict as people take on rulers whose power typically vastly exceeds their own. And even though these movements have been very influential in our thinking about nationalism, there's actually fewer studies that address the origins of nationalist movements than you might expect. That's somewhat unfortunate, because I think the colonial cases provide a real opportunity to think about how nationalist conflict begins. Current cases can be really hard to study because there's partisan biases. Oftentimes when a conflict is ongoing, like the conflicts that have only recently been ongoing in Afghanistan and Iraq, it can be very difficult to collect information. Information can be biased. It can be hard to get access to good records. So I'll start by talking a little bit about my book, and then later on in the talk, I'll talk about my current book project, which flips the perspective and looks at it from the point of view of the colonial power. And I'll talk about how Europeans approach the project of ruling over people in distant lands. This new project reflects my interest in understanding how it is that people from different religious, ethnic, national, or ideological backgrounds negotiate their relationships with one another. And I consider how foreign powers are able to rule over people who are really very different from their own population. But let me begin by talking about the end of the formal colonial period. So in the 25 years that followed World War II, European empires confronted waves of mobilization for independence. The history of these nationalist movements has had a profound influence on the way we think about conflict between nations, the effects of foreign rule, and the power of nationalism to mobilize large numbers of people to either vote or protest or even to take up arms. Despite the influence of these cases, as I said, there's been fewer works that investigate the origins of nationalist movements, because often the focus has been on the European empires and their collapse. So why did the British Empire collapse, or why did the French Empire collapse? And nationalist movements are considered as one thing that affected that, but they're not really the focus. Other studies have focused on the consequences of the colonial period for the post-colonial period and for today. But many studies of former colonies in Africa and Asia do little more than just note that there was a wave in the mid-century of independence movements. And oftentimes these nationalist movements aren't really investigated because it seems obvious in hindsight, with our knowledge of the rapid collapse of the formal European empires, that populations were going to reject imperial rule. So the conventional wisdom treats nationalist movements for independence as a natural consequence of the existence of empires in an age of nationalism. So it's taken as a given that nationalism was the primary political force in colonial states. And in this view, the continuation, differences of identity, differences between the identity of colonial rulers and colonized populations rendered the continuation of a common sovereignty unacceptable to colonized populations. So looking back at the colonial era now from decades later, nationalist movements make sense. You know, they don't seem to require that much explanation or interrogation. And this is a scene from the very well-known movie, The Battle of Algiers, which is a really terrific movie. And it's a film, though, that reflects this conventional view. You know, throughout the film, it shows the French on one side and the Algerians on the other side. And it shows them as on opposing and mutually incomprehensible sides. And the movie implies that Algerians were bound to demand their independence as a nation from France. So what the book tries to do is to contest this account and argue against taking nationalist responses for granted. And the book shows that the reactions that colonized populations had to imperial rule really varied quite a bit. They varied in terms of what people asked for and in when they saw independence. So in my talk today, I'm going to focus on three questions, two of which I consider in the book. So the first is, you know, nationalism wasn't the only discourse of anti-colonialism. So I consider first, why did it become so widespread? And I'll talk a little bit about how elites in the colonies sought first to reform colonial rule and make it more equitable, turning only to nationalism when that failed. Then I'll talk a little bit about the timing of nationalist protests, and I'll argue that it often took off when imperial rule was disrupted by wartime invasions or by decolonization itself. Considering these questions in the process of writing the book led me to think about a third question that's the subject of my current project. And again, that focuses not on indigenous reactions to colonial rule, but on colonial approaches. I'm studying the different ways that colonial powers tried to control their conquered territories. So the remainder of the talk is organized around these three questions, and I won't spend as much time on the second. I'm happy to take any questions that you have on any of the three. But let me start first by explaining what my empirical strategy was, what my case selection was. So the book tacked back and forth between two levels of analysis. And the first was what we call a comparative historical approach, comparing broadly across cases in the 20th century French Empire. Now, comparing within one empire, and within the French Empire in particular, had a couple of advantages. First, most studies of the colonial period or of decolonization often compare across empires. So they would compare the British Empire to the French Empire to the Portuguese Empire. But when you do that, it's then very natural to look at the differences between the colonial powers themselves. So look at, you know, how are the French different from the British, for example. And it detracts from looking at differences in how nationalism and decolonization occurred within empires. Nationalist mobilization didn't happen in the same place, in the same way in every place within an empire, within the French Empire or the British Empire. So when you take the empire as the unit of analysis, you're forced to overgeneralize and ignore some of what was going on very differently within colonies, within empires. Another advantage of the French Empire is that there's a lot of diversity in the colonial experience. So the timing of nationalist mobilization was very different. In places like Syria and Lebanon, nationalist resistance to French rule started even as France was entering Syria and Lebanon and starting their colonial period there. But in other places, nationalist responses didn't come until very late. So widespread nationalist mobilization didn't happen in Algeria until war broke out in 1954. In other parts of sub-Saharan Africa, there was no nationalist mobilization until 1960 or close to 1960. There are other kinds of variation as well. Some places were promised assimilation into France while others were not. Violence also varied. There were many nonviolent movements in the French Empire. But there were also violent uprisings in Syria, Madagascar, and Morocco, and there were lengthy anti-colonial wars in Vietnam and Algeria. And I'm also happy to talk about some work of mine that looks at why did some of these conflicts turn violent, if you like, in the Q&A. So the other level of analysis was to look within colonies. So I drew on my regional expertise in the Arab world, and particularly in North Africa. And today I'll talk mostly about Algeria and Morocco to illustrate my arguments. Morocco's a country where I've spent about 5 years living and doing research and working. I did research for my book, including some interviews with former nationalists. More recently, I did research there during the Arab Spring with activists who are trying to push a democracy platform, and I'm also happy to talk more about that too. And for the book, I went to archives in Morocco and in France to gather police and intelligence reports on the political and economic situation in Morocco during the protectorate period. So what I did was to, as a political scientist, you know, collect a kind of database of reports. And there were 263 months of French rule for which I had reports. And this is a sample of one of the police reports. The reports were divided up into three sections typically. They would have a sort of general situation, as this one does, and then it would list, you know, what's the situation with the Muslims, with the European community, and with the Jews. So it was often divided by identity. This report happens to take place in 1955 when there was a violent uprising against French rule, so it describes some of the attacks against the French. So each report described any anti-colonial activity that occurred and also how the French responded. And it was while reading these reports on Morocco that I began asking the first question, you know, why and how did nationalism become the discourse of anti-colonialism? But at the outset of the project, when I set off as a graduate student from Chicago, I didn't expect to answer this question. It wasn't one of my initial research questions. My plan, when I arrived at the colonial archives, was to construct a data set of nationalist events for Morocco, and I thought that was going to be very straightforward. I was going to collect, you know, every protest event, every kind of riot that occurred, and put them into a spreadsheet and try to figure out what the patterns were. But when I began to look through the reports in order to collect information on these events, I found myself unable to answer a really basic question, which was, you know, what counts as a nationalist event? I read about religious mobilization in which the new Salafia movement was arguing that the Sufi brotherhoods were practicing Islam in a way that was not legitimate, and they were trying to shut down some of the brotherhood's practices. I read about disputes over water sharing, where Moroccans contested the division of water between European settlers and Moroccans. I read about a strike in Casablanca, where French and Moroccan workers walked together in the streets to ask for better wages. And I also read about protest movements, you know, protests demanding independence. So, you know, which of these things were nationalist, or were they all nationalist? The French tended to call Moroccans who were criticizing them or acting against the regime in any way nationalist. But were these all instances of the same thing? You know, from my reading of the literature before I went there, I didn't really expect to see so much diversity in what it was that colonized people asked for when they contested the imperial regime. From my reading of the literature, I expected that most mobilization in Morocco would be about nationalism. And that is to say that protesters and local populations would mount their challenges to French rule using the language of nationalism. So what is that language? What's the language of nationalism? I use a classic definition here from the scholar Ernest Gellner, who defined it as a political principle that nations have an inherent right to self-determination. Nationalism could be thought of as a membership rule, you know, as a way to define who's inside and who's outside of the community. Now, I thought that all protest in Morocco, certainly, would be about this, that this would be the abiding concern. You know, why did I think that? Morocco was colonized late in the history of imperialism. It was not colonized by the French until 1912, and it wasn't fully conquered until 1934. There was already a state-like form there with a recognized sovereign leader in the Moroccan Sultan, who came from a dynasty that had ruled in Morocco since the 17th century. There was already a known sense of nationality, or an idea that there was a people and they were a Moroccan people. So there was a history of nationhood. And that's why I was so surprised that not all political protest espoused this nationalist principle. And not all opposition emphasized the national cleavage. In fact, in Morocco and elsewhere in the French Empire, there was another big idea that mobilized opponents of empire, and it was one that de-emphasized national differences. So political elites in the colonies and in Morocco called on the French principles of equality, fraternity, and liberty. And that tended to take two forms. So in a place like Morocco, which was a protectorate during the colonial period, so they kept the Sultan and they ruled with him, political elites and Moroccan elites sought reforms that would allow natives to participate in the administration, and that's what they wanted. They asked for democratic institutions that would provide local representation. So what Moroccans objected to was that there was representation for the Europeans living in Morocco. There was a way for them to say what they wanted and to contact the government, but there was no such institution for Moroccans. So initially, that's what they asked for. Now, in the colonies, in the more long-standing French colonies like Algeria, assimilation had been the stated policy. And there, the desire for political equality took the form of asking for French citizenship, asking for the French to live up their promises to assimilate the population and extend French citizenship. I was very surprised to find that there was this commonality between Morocco and Algeria, that they both talked in this language of political equality. Algeria was the most important colonial possession for France. It was like the equivalent of India for Britain. It was so important that the French made Algeria into three departments. So a department is like a state in the United States. So they made Algeria a département of France, which is the central and crucial part of France. Assimilation there was the official policy, so it made sense to me that some Algerians would mobilize around this goal. But even in a place like Morocco, where the colonial period was very short and where it came very late, we also see people arguing about ways to reduce the inequalities of the colonial state. In hindsight, it's very easy to subsume all anti-colonialism under a national umbrella, to see it all as nationalism. Because national identity appears to define the sides in the conflict, you know, the French versus the Algerians, or the Moroccans versus the French. But if we look at what opponents of empire said, a more complex picture emerges. Colonial subjects who were engaged in opposing the colonialism made very diverse demands on imperial rulers. They didn't solely, or even all that often, emphasize national divides. There are also other forms of anti-colonialism that I'm not going to talk about today, like communist movements or movements that emphasize transnational identities or religious movements as well. So there's a big diversity in this. Now, part of the reason that this diversity of demands goes unnoticed is that in many, but not all places, the discourse of opposition shifted towards nationalist demands for independent statehood. So why did that happen? The most common accounts suggest that this quest for reform to make colonial rule more equitable was a stage in the nationalist struggle. It was a step on the way to nationalist resistance. So calls for representative institutions or to be treated as the equals of French settlers and citizens were bound to be supplanted by nationalist demands as movements gained maturity, and that was the logic of the argument. Nationalists themselves claimed this retrospectively. So in their memoirs, they said that asking for reforms was a stepping stone and that they would later ask for, they intended to ask for nationalism later on. And scholars have also suggested this as well. For Morocco, scholars called the early demands for reform in the 20s and 30s proto-nationalism or early nationalism. So the argument that I make in the book is that it's not that these demands were bound to morph into nationalism, but that it was the denial of these demands that led to nationalism. So exclusion produced nationalism, but political inclusion did not. This argument helps to account for some things that are very puzzling about the colonial period. First, why so many places didn't really turn nationalist until very late. I mean, now 1950 seems like a long time ago, but that's well into the age of nationalism. So why are so many places still not making nationalist demands that late? When political equality was on the table, when it was a possibility, when it was still under discussion in France, people mobilized around that. Also, there were a few places in the empire that never saw nationalist mobilization, and that's also puzzling to us in an era of where nationalism is a very widespread sentiment. Now, there's a very long-standing debate in French historical circles over which one of these things is right, you know, which one of these ideas is right. And in particular, one of the things that the French have grasped with is the question of Algeria. So if, then this particular counterfactual that I want to emphasize, that, you know, what if France had granted citizenship to Algeria? Would we have had an Algerian War of Independence? Would Algeria have separated from France? This is an ongoing question that people ask about Algeria. And, you know, it's, of course, like any counterfactual, not really knowable. We can't go back and rerun history and see what would have happened if the French had granted citizenship to Algeria. Would Algerians have turned nationalist anyway? Or would they have stayed within France? But that's the counterfactual that my argument keeps in mind. So let me talk a little bit about Algeria. In Algeria, there was a long movement for assimilation. And this was only eclipsed at the very end of the period by the National Liberation Front that fought for Algerian independence. Calls for French citizenship for Algerian Muslims were still heard right up until the war broke out in 1954. And in 1937, when a leftist group was in power in France, the Popular Front, it almost came to pass. It nearly came to pass. Maurice Violette presented a bill in the French National Assembly that would have given French citizenship to a small number of Algerians. As they put it, Algerians who were considered evolved or enough like the French to merit citizenship. So what it would have done is given French citizenship to 20,000 Algerians. It was a very modest plan, and the idea, though, was that this could gradually be extended to the Algerian population. And its proponents made the argument that by doing this, this was going to allow France to permanently tie Algeria to France. And again, you know, it was the most important French possession. Now, in response to a lot of opposition to the bill from colonial settlers and their representatives, Maurice Violette, who proposed the bill, said this, and I'll just give you a second to read it. So Violette here is predicting that denying demands for citizenship would lead to nationalist mobilization. But he didn't successfully make the argument, and the bill was turned down. And from 1937 on, there were, you know, some steps made towards citizenship and some steps made away from it. But France repeatedly rejected the calls to make good on its promises for assimilation. And this had consequences. So during World War II, a key proponent of assimilation, one of the Algerians who was married to a French woman who had argued in favor of assimilation, started to flip, and he started to talk about the necessity of independence. He issued a manifesto during the war, and it was put out with this addendum which said, politically and morally, this colonialism can have no concept other than that of two societies, one foreign to the other. Its refusal, systematic or disguised, to give French citizenship to Algerian Muslims has discouraged the partisans of the policy of assimilation extended to the natives. This policy appears today, in the eyes of all, as an inaccessible thing, a dangerous device placed at the service of colonialism. Now, you know, we can't really know what would have happened in Algeria or in Morocco if France made moves towards political equality, because they never did. So we have to look at other cases to try to evaluate this counterfactual. And in 1946, France implemented a few different policies for the colonies. And, you know, at the most rough characterization, six places were incorporated into France, meaning that six places got full citizenship. And of those six places, none of them had nationalist movements within 10 years. Of the places that didn't get French citizenship, they all had nationalist movements in the next 10 years. But let me show you the list of the places. So the places that got French citizenship are today still part of France, and they're known as the Dom Toms. So what happened there after they were given French citizenship in 1946? You know, did it lead to nationalist demands as the conventionalist literature would predict? Was it a stepping stone? In fact, what happened after the extension of citizenship to these places was that mobilization for citizenship continued, that what people asked for was to deepen the relationship with France, for France to incorporate, to engage in more measures of incorporation and help equalize things between those places. So it didn't. They didn't use political equality as a stepping stone to ask for nationalist demands, as the conventional wisdom predicts. Now the problem with these kind of comparison is that these cases are also all really small places. They're like small islands that were not so hard to give political equality to. And so that makes them hard to use as a counterfactual. They're very difficult. It's very difficult to compare like small island cases to much larger places and to know, you know, is what happened in Martinique and Guadeloupe a good counterfactual for what would have happened in Algeria? Fortunately, We do have some other differing experiences on this right side among the places that were ultimately politically excluded. And let me just talk a little bit about Senegal, because I think Senegal is a good case for the theory. It's a big country, majority Muslim country, and it also did experience French citizenship. So at the beginning of the 20th century, citizenship was extended to part of Senegal, but not all. So it was extended to the four communes, these four places that you see up here. And the same thing that happened in Guadeloupe and Martinique also happened in these four places. The Africans who had been given French citizenship defended their rights as citizens. Some of them made the argument that citizenship should be extended to all of Senegal. And they pointed to their own experience as well as the experience of people in places like Guadeloupe and Martinique to make the argument that the Senegalese could be French citizens just as citizens in France were French citizens. So they defended their rights. Some of them said, you know what, we shouldn't make the argument about the rest of Senegal. We should try to keep on our privileges, because if we try to make this argument that we should extend citizenship to all of Senegal, we might get our rights taken away. So there was some debate within them. In 1946, however, this special status for these four places was taken away. All of Senegal became what was known as French Union citizens, which also happened throughout the colonies in French Africa, French West Africa, and French Equatorial Africa. This was a kind of a step towards promising citizenship, but it didn't come with all the same rights that the French citizens had in France, and it was later revoked right before the end of the colonial period. So let me sum up and explain how I think this argument helps us to understand colonial history, and also maybe helps us to think about nationalist conflict in general. You know, existing narratives about the development of nationalism overlook a crucial aspect of the history of anti-colonialism. And that is that in most of France's colonies, even a protectorate like Morocco that already had a recognized nationality, nationalist mobilization was preceded for many years by integrative movements for political equality under French rule. So it was the authoritarian nature, not the foreign nature, of colonial rule that initially drew criticism. Anti-colonialists concentrated not on who ruled, but on how they ruled. And the argument is that nationalist aims became dominant only when leaders in the colonies found the route to equality within France closed. So France's colonial subjects sought an exit, not because they were different from the French, but because the French refused to treat them as political equals. So it mattered whether the French treated people as inferior subjects or political equals. Now, you know, only a small number of people in the French Empire actually got citizenship at the end of the day. So, you know, why should we care about this? Well, and I want to emphasize here that I think this is an interesting and valuable argument, no matter how tiny the number of people is that actually got French citizenship. And that's because the literature that we have implies that political equality was impossible or doomed because it would have been unacceptable to colonized populations whose aspirations were bound to turn nationalists. In contrast, what I hoped to show was that colonized people were willing to entertain incorporation on fair and just terms. It was the French who couldn't live up to their inclusionary rhetoric. And that subjects were willing is something that we rarely hear. And it's an important lesson because it suggests that a higher degree of equality between an occupying power and those who are occupied might work to diffuse conflict. Now, foreign rulers in a variety of contexts have retrospectively explained outbursts of nationalist resistance by claiming that people were bound to oppose them no matter what they did. Those claims are often self-serving. By claiming that intergroup antagonism is natural, foreign rulers are able to avoid taking responsibility for their own failed policies. And more generally, the assumption that nations have a tendency to be in conflict with one another leads us to fail to investigate the factors that fuel antagonism. And it's this intergroup antagonism that I find so fascinating, and that's, you know, at the heart of my research agenda. So let me more briefly preview the second question the book addressed. So it's not the case that people automatically took to the streets when these movements for political equality failed. You know, they needed more than a motive. They also needed opportunities to act. And organizing protests against a colonial regime is hard. And that's a point that the existing literature misses. By taking nationalist protests as the logical reaction to unjust colonial rule, the literature fails to address just how difficult it is to get people to take to the streets, particularly when doing so entails really significant risks. Now, using those reports on Morocco, I looked at, you know, how often did the French repress protesters by beating them or firing them or arresting them, and I found that they used repression against protesters in roughly one-third of the period, like 71 out of 260 months. So opposing the French was dangerous and it was costly. So how did it get going? You know, in the book I suggest that mass mobilization occurred when colonial rule was disrupted. Now, what's a disruption? I tried to define it as a very serious rupture in the ability of the colonial power to govern and control a territory. So it's a place where control is either partial, where there's another authority, or where the imperial authority's control has been destroyed. And that happened in the French Empire in two common situations: when there was an invasion of another power during war, or when the French themselves decided to withdraw. A lot of arguments suggest the opposite of this, that it's nationalist mobilization that causes a disruption in authority. But in fact, disruptions in the imperial power's ability to control a territory often preceded and prompted nationalist protest. And nationalist protest then made it much harder, again, for the imperial rule to maintain control. So, you know, in the book I look at several different time periods and cases. I'm just going to talk a little bit here about the empire during World War II. World War II is often thought as a very critical period for colonial rule, especially for the French, who had been defeated by Germany in 1940. Nationalist protests had already begun in some places by the time World War II started, but it really seemed to take off during World War II. However, what we see in the French Empire is that there's only nationalist protest in the places where French rule was disrupted by the arrival of outside forces. So these are all the places that during World War II had another power come in with their forces and occupy them. Almost all of them, all but one, saw nationalist movements right after that invasion. There's also 22 cases, the other cases that were on the first chart that aren't listed here, and none of them had nationalist mobilization during the war. Now, this is a long list of cases and a very general pattern. So let me just say a few things about North Africa, where the Allied landings in late 1942 provided a very crucial moment that set off nationalist uncertainty. So in Morocco, as I was reading through those reports, as late as 1942, the French monthly report said that, quote, "the attachment Moroccans have to France is deeper and more sincere than ever." But it was only a few months later, after the Allied invasion, that they were to start experiencing nationalist protests for the first time in French Morocco. What happened was the Allies, including the Americans, landed in Morocco, and that prompted a lot of rumors, that maybe the Americans were going to replace the French or that the French were about to leave. Roosevelt reportedly was said to have supported Moroccan independence. Meetings began to be held, and the Istiklal Party, which means independence, formed, and they asked for the first time in an open and public way for independence for French Morocco following the American invasion. So disruptions, like the American landing in Casablanca, which is shown up there, made independence seem thinkable. And focusing on disruptions helps us to account for why protest begins in some places but not in others. Beyond the colonial period, it also suggests a different way of thinking about the role of nationalism. We tend to think of nationalism as a potential cause of conflict, as preceding and creating instability, rather than being a response to instability. And that comes from understanding nationalism as a stable property, as, you know, part of a group's essence. But nationalist mobilization happens in time and space. You know, it fluctuates, it becomes more salient at some points than at others. Policymakers often tend to think of national and ethnic commitments as being long-standing, as being, you know, a sort of pre-existing problem that you might encounter in a particular place. But they might have the causal arrow going in the wrong direction. They might think that it's nationalist organizing that causes a foreign intervention to fail, but in fact it could be the other way around, that it's a failing foreign intervention that is producing dynamics leading to nationalism. Both of the arguments of the book suggest that nationalist protest was contingent It wasn't an obvious or predictable result of colonial rule, you know, despite all of its injustices. Before vibrant nationalist movements erupted, efforts to redress the inequalities between colonial subjects and colonials and citizens had to be abandoned, and there had to also be opportunities to mobilize. And the idea that nationalist mobilization was predictable is evident really only in retrospect. So at the time that decolonization occurred, no one predicted that nationalist movements would erupt across the colonial world any more than they predicted the collapse of the Soviet Union or the Arab Spring in our time. So let me just turn to my third and final question. So the book, you know, focused on anti-colonialists and devoted less time and attention to French decision making, but it did raise some questions about how the French approached rule in the colonies. You know, why was assimilation held out as a possibility for some places but not for others? So let me lay out for you some of the questions that I'm considering in my current book project, which is very much a work in progress, and I welcome your comments and suggestions. So when European imperial powers conquered North Africa and Sub-Saharan Africa in the 19th and early 20th centuries, they took on this project of ruling populations that differed from them along ethnic, racial, linguistic, and religious lines. Now, we can broadly sort the approaches that they took into two categories. You know, the first kind of way that they approached it was a transformative logic that justified colonialism as a civilizing project that would modernize and transform colonial territories. The conquering state provided a model that its colonies could emulate. European bureaucracies, laws, and modes of economic exchange would be transplanted to the colonies. So this transformative logic is associated with direct rule and with replacing what was already there, what you find with sort of European rulers. And French moves towards citizenship are an example of this kind of transformative logic. In contrast, the second approach, or indirect rule, sought to preserve native culture and traditions instead of transforming them. So it aimed to make use of local leaders. And here is Frederick Lugard standing with some African chiefs. He's a major figure in the theory of indirect rule. He laid it out in his out the logic of it in his 1922 book, The Dual Mandate in British Tropical Africa. Very loosely speaking, indirect rule became the preferred approach as the 19th century gave way to the 20th. The French began speaking of association instead of assimilation. But even as the overarching aims of and justifications for colonialism shifted from a transformative logic to a preservationist one, in practice, on the ground, imperial strategies continued to vary all the way through the colonial period. And that's the variation that's at the center of my new project. So let me talk a little bit about some of the questions I'm asking. So European powers, and my focus here is on France and Great Britain, employed both direct and indirect approaches in their empires throughout the colonial period. So how did they choose between them? You know, what explains why they used direct or indirect rule? Who favored those kinds of rules and why? And to even begin to answer these two questions, we have to think about, you know, what it means to say that rule is either direct or indirect. And a lot of some political theorists have talked about these terms and studied what they meant for people who were thinkers in the metropole, in France and England. But what I'm interested in is what did these terms mean on the ground in colonies? So let me start with, you know, this last question, the definition of indirect and direct rule. So one way of conceptualizing and defining these terms reflects the ways that they were explained by the colonialists themselves. So colonialists claimed that indirect rule was less disruptive than direct rule because it relied on already existing authorities. And a recent article in World Politics conceptualizes indirect rule as a continuum, not as two types. And the continuum represents the amount of power that you delegate to pre-colonial leaders. So they see indirect rule as a decentralized framework where you delegate some decision powers to the weaker entity. So in their understanding, greater independent authority implies indirect rule and greater dependence implies direct rule. In contrast with this, direct rule was disruptive because it imposed European leaders, laws, and institutions on indigenous populations. So that's one way of looking at these two concepts. But there's a notable opponent of this view that stands out, And that's the scholar Mahmoud Mamdani, who doesn't think that indirect rule preserves continuity with the pre-colonial past. Instead, he argues that indirect rule was just as disruptive, if not more so. He says indirect rule was the more hegemonic assertion of colonial power because it empowered local leaders in Africa and elsewhere in ways that they hadn't been before. So for other scholars, indirect rule recognizes and takes advantage of the authority of local leaders. It's their pre-existing power that causes them to become useful intermediaries for the European power. But for Mamdani, it's their role as intermediaries that then causes them to become powerful. So my project isn't to decide which one was worse, direct or indirect rule. But the tension between these viewpoints suggests that there's a lot more that we need to know about what these kinds of rule actually entailed. You know, can we take as a given the existence of pre-colonial leaders who just continued in their same role? Is that part of what defines indirect rule and sets it apart from direct rule? Or did indirect rule actually change forms of political authority, as Mamdani suggests? You know, and if so, then how did direct and indirect rule differ? So let me try a different kind of definition. Now, I think a better definition would not assume a certain amount of power division between the colonial power and the local elites, but instead would turn that into a question. So the balance of power between the local intermediaries and the British or the French, maybe we should think of that as something that varies and not as something that's a defining feature. So here's a couple of characteristics that I do think differentiate direct rule and indirect rule. First is the identity of the leaders. So in areas of indirect rule, regardless of how much power they had, you know, at least these chiefs we saw before, these African chiefs, were named as leaders. Whereas in areas of direct rule, the leaders were European. But they also differed in another way, and that was the legal system. So under indirect rule, the British and the French typically decided to leave the legal structure in place. So they left customary law in place. And that could vary. So it could vary from village to village or from tribe to tribe. So there's lots of different legal structures. Direct rule, in contrast, offered a single system of law. That single system wasn't a fair system. So I'm not saying it was fairer for indigenous actors. But there was a centralized legal structure. So why did you get direct or indirect rule in particular colonial areas? Let me talk about two of the factors that tend to get mentioned the most. The first is the costs. So one of the big advantages of indirect rule, touted by its proponents, was that it was going to be cheaper than direct rule. And Jules Ferry, speaking about the newly established protectorate in Tunisia in 1884, said that they should keep the Ottoman Bey in place instead of ruling directly, and that that would free us from installing a French administration in this country, which is to say it frees us from imposing significant burdens on the French budget. It allows us to supervise from above, to govern from above, to avoid taking on, in spite of ourselves, responsibility for all details of administration. So this cost question was very important, particularly in areas where Europeans couldn't settle or didn't want to settle, or in rural areas, or in areas with high disease environments. And the argument, you know, about cost also suggests that colonialists ought to prefer indirect rule if it's cheaper. So all else equal, we should choose indirect rule over direct rule. But maybe there aren't, you know, local leaders who are available to collaborate. So if you don't have partners, if you're operating in a kind of stateless society, you have to rule directly. And that's the argument of that article that was in World Politics by Gehring. They find that indirect rule was more likely where there was already pre-colonial leaders that you could deal with. But what I want to suggest is that I don't think either of these two factors were determinative. And they weren't determinative for a few reasons. First of all, just because you had local leaders didn't mean that they were going to want to work with the colonial power. They might resist instead of collaborating. And in another international relations book, Paul MacDonald shows that strong elites tended to cooperate to resist conquest altogether. So, you know, just because they're there doesn't mean they're going to be on your side. Second, if you don't find leaders, maybe you can just create leaders. And this is something the British tried to do in Africa when they created warrant chiefs. So it's puzzling that they did this if what they were looking for was people who already had legitimacy and authority. And then, you know, finally, even if there are local leaders and they're there and they're willing to work with you initially, a lot can change over time. You know, a partnership could weaken rather than strengthen a leader, so they have to be replaced. The British and the French frequently fired different chiefs over time periods. You know, if we look at the case of Morocco, the French spent a lot of time when they initially went to Morocco working with the Sultan, turning him into a partner of theirs. And by doing that, they actually weakened his legitimacy with the rest of the population. They spent all this time investing in this relationship, and eventually he had to abdicate and they had to start all over again with the new Sultan. That new Sultan was then compliant and worked with them until the American invasion, when he flipped and started becoming a nationalist instead. So, you know, just because you have an ally at one time doesn't mean that alliance is gonna last. So I'm not saying that, you know, costs don't have any effect or the initial conditions, but I think what we have to do is think about the incentives for different European actors. And, you know, what I want to suggest is that indirect rule served particular purposes. And what I'm considering is that, you know, indirect rule was favored by colonial actors whose main concern was to secure territorial control. And indirect rule solved a problem for those actors because it allowed them to delegate the use of force to indigenous leaders who were charged with maintaining stability and preventing disorder. This delegation was very useful because it distanced the colonial power from acts of force. And when there was violence, the colonial power that got into the newspapers in France or in Britain, the colonial power could say, you know, that's really native tradition. It had nothing to do with colonial rule. The ability to pass off the coercion that was exercised by local intermediaries as a manifestation of tradition provided a way for colonial powers to deflect responsibility for coercion that may have been useful or even essential for the colonial project, for getting some things done, like building railroads and these kinds of projects that required labor that sometimes you needed to force people to do. So C.L. Temple, who was a lieutenant governor in northern Nigeria from 1914 to 1917, explained in the book Native Races and Their Rulers, quote, "To put this policy into effect means, first of all, that you must shut your eyes up to a certain point to a great many practices which, though not absolutely repugnant to humanity, are nevertheless reprehensible to our ideas. You have to make up your mind that men are not all equal before the law and cannot be so treated." Now, this need for colonial officials to shut their eyes to the brutality that occurred during the colonial period could be taken to imply a necessary lack of accountability that happens when you delegate to local leaders. But brutality itself may have been useful, particularly for colonial militaries, both because the coercion that was exercised by local leaders could have helped to squelch rebellion and to get the compliance of the population, and because ongoing violence and barbarism justified the need for continuous military oversight. In contrast, direct rule entailed a very different way of thinking about how you control a population. And that was a sort of bureaucratic form of control via the rule of law. The aim in areas of direct rule was an administrative one, to regulate the natives by using the law. And the law established different rules for natives than for Europeans, so it wasn't more just, but it was distinct from areas of military rule. And it was often favored by settlers and civilian administration. And this is, you know, the argument that's still in progress and I'm still developing. And I've been looking particularly at Algeria, because there we had both kinds of areas of military control and civilian control. And what I was surprised to find when I started reading about Algeria in the early colonial period is that the French military leaders advocating this kind of preservative indirect rule logic, saying we have to respect local tradition, we have to preserve local leaders. And the reason I was surprised is because the French military in Algeria had also been very brutal. You know, it had engaged in a lot of brutal practices. You know, at one point during the conquest, chasing an entire village into a cave, lighting a fire and smoking the entire village to death. So then I started wondering, you know, why is it that they're doing these kinds of things? And then on the other hand, articulating a logic that says we need to respect local traditions and authority. We need to think some more about what this kind of rule did for these actors. Studying indirect and direct rule during the late colonial period, you know, it might seem like a question for history. And it is important for understanding how Europeans managed to rule over diverse populations that were at a great distance away from imperial centers. But I also want to think a little bit about, you know, why this topic might matter for more contemporary concerns. You know, first, there's it has the potential to help us understand some of the consequences of the colonial period. There's a lot of work that has found that the colonial period has had persistent legacies that last up until today. And direct and indirect rule specifically have been linked to nationalist resistance, to the empowerment of privileged groups, to economic underdevelopment, and to autocracy today. But we don't really know why these associations exist because our knowledge of colonial practices is lacking. So maybe this argument can help us account for some existing findings. So for instance, there's a few large and, you know, cross-national statistical studies have found that places that were under indirect rule are more likely to be autocratic today. You know, and now, and if it's the case that indirect rule really did protect traditions that were coercive, that allowed effective autocratic control during the colonial period, then that might help us to understand why they've continued to be that way today. The project also has implications for understanding how people in general respond to foreign conquest. There's a common perception, and it still lasts in counterinsurgency discussions of, you know, the US in Iraq or in Syria and Afghanistan, there's a common perception that indirect rule is more acceptable and less likely to provoke rebellion because a place's own leaders are going to be more legitimate. But if indirect rule empowers local leaders who use violence and coercion, we might mistakenly conclude that compliance is due to legitimacy when in fact it's the use of violence that's achieving compliance. So indirect rule might work when it does, not because it's more acceptable to local populations, but because local justice means that there are a variety of coercive tools that can be used to suppress dissent. So if that's the case, then foreign occupations that focus on installing an indigenous leadership might find that instead of, you know, making things better or making the government more acceptable, they may be fostering new forms of violence. And I'll conclude with that and look forward to your questions. Thanks. This is a picture, I think, that a student in Morocco drew to commemorate part of the anti-colonial struggle in Morocco, in which, you know, some of them are attacking this car that contains a French general and a new sultan that they put in place, that the French appointed and put in place after the old sultan became too much of a nationalist. So then, and now they're being mobbed.
Anyway, I'm happy to take questions. Yes, hi.
Study approach with other examples such as India or the British Empire. But I wonder whether one of the factors that increased the level of mobilization after World War II was that what was going on around the French colonies, especially with other states being created, and with India becoming its own state. So it was not only something that was endogenous, but also something that was exogenous in that sense, and that some of the experiences they were hoping for actually were coming to them from what other people were experiencing at the same time, more or less. The second question has to do with a bit more of clarity in the use of words. And I heard the word assimilation, and I heard the word inclusion. And I wanted to know, maybe that's what I understood from your talk, whether or not you are using those interchangeably. Because in French, assimilation has the strongest possible meaning of assimilation. Legally, and in the attempt made by the government, the French state, over many decades to assimilate citizens from the colonies. Whereas inclusion is softer in nature. Inclusion implies a little bit more of synergy in that sense in how we view people. The example I can give you with assimilation is educational policies, for instance, in Algeria. You know, if you are a child in a second grade class in Algeria, 1948, as an example, the textbooks you use are the ones determined by Paris. Mm-hmm. And those textbooks tell you, you are the descendants of the Gauls. In northern France, you are this Gaul, you are blue-eyed, and you are blonde. And so that's the type of civilization the French state was looking for. You become like us, which unfortunately, to some extent, is still true today. And that's one of the reasons why we have so many problems in France. The third question is about this dichotomy between indirect rule versus direct rule. And my first reaction was, can you really find a one system fits all situation in which one single country would say, okay, for all the colonies we have, we're going to go with indirect rule, or for all the colonies, we're going to go with direct rule? Because I found it a bit difficult to believe that. I would think probably governments that are really driven by the situations will try to mix a little bit to try to see what is the best fit for this specific country that we're trying to control. So why not try to understand whether or not, instead of direct versus indirect, whether or not there are other factors that are useful in seeing why those choices were made, such as, for instance, the type of political system the country had to begin with. So France, up until 62, was a parliamentary system, a very messy one to begin with, and clearly not a good example of direct rule. Yet after that became a presidential system, a much more efficient one in that sense. So maybe that may cause an issue here, whether or not you are parliamentary versus presidential in nature. And the second suggestion that came in has to do with the level of ethnic and religious homogeneity of the colony we're talking about. Because obviously, Nigeria is the quintessential example of why there were so many problems in stability in colonies after they broke free. And it is that, how do you deal with countries that are very diverse in so many ways, and they're trying to learn on their own how to be themselves. Mm-hmm.
Great, thanks. Those are excellent questions, and that's a lot to think about. Let me just say something. I want to leave a lot of time for everyone, so I'll try to be quick in my answer here. But the first question about linkages to international events, one of the things I considered when I started trying to look at this disruptions argument was, you know, I was trying to figure out whether there was a model of diffusion, because we do see it as a wave, right? We see it as, you know, independence movements taking place in the mid-20th century, and they vary in time. You know, some of them are getting underway in the 20s, and some of them are later. So are they taking inspiration from other places? I think in some sense they are, you know, so that when you're reading the writings of nationalists, that they take inspiration from people like Gandhi in India. But I think when you try to map out how that might have affected things, it's very difficult to do in terms of figuring out the, you know, how you would explain the timing, right? So the cases that I put up here in France during World War II, they all had nationalist mobilization, I'd say, like before India declared independence, right? Before the 1946 independence. So would they couldn't have been influenced by that, but they could still have been influenced by the ideas of Gandhi. So what I came to think was that what happened was these ideas are influential, but it still helps to have a propitious opportunity during which they can be expressed. Because the places that didn't have nationalist mobilization during World War II also had these same examples and these same models, but they didn't have the same kind of disruption to the government that the others experienced. I think you're right to stress that, you know, maybe I'm mistaken to use assimilation and inclusionary rhetoric. They're not the same thing. I think that, you know, by assimilation, what the Algerians and many other parts of the colonies are asking for is citizenship. But when I talk about inclusionary rhetoric, I think that, you know, that's the common thing across the empire. So whether you wanted French citizenship, which people in Morocco did not, they still wanted to be included, you know, in the same kinds of institutions and democratic institutions. And oftentimes they made an argument that maybe, you know, I think what your comments suggest is that, you know, that inclusion and assimilation aren't the same thing, right? So that, or maybe they're even in contradiction with each other, according to the example you're giving of the Algerian textbooks. Because what they tried to make the argument was that we could become politically French without becoming French. You know, we didn't have to turn into Frenchmen and be descended from the Gauls, right? We could, and leaders in Senegal and, you know, in Ivory Coast and in Algeria made this argument. And what they were really doing was something that was very revolutionary, which was challenging what it meant to be French by saying we can be just as French as a French person, even if we have a different color of skin, even if we have a different religion, because those aren't central to the core of what France is or what it should be. The promise of France is its republican ideology, not any kind of an ethnic nationalism. I don't think that we'll find a case either that is clearly indirect or direct rule at the country level. And so what I'm interested in is this kind of subnational variation. I mean, maybe they had some strategies of we're going to approach this colony using indirect rule, but in practice, it's going to vary. So I completely agree about that. And I think that, you know, as I'm thinking through this project and where it's going, it's, you know, maybe more of a project, maybe what I would like it to be is more of a project about colonial governance and about how you govern people from who are very diverse and different from the ruler, and less about it being, you know, just these specific types. But I'd be happy to talk more to you about that. Yes?
Your presentation made me think about France and how it deals with the racial identity. I know that France has colorblind policy where they don't identify race in their census. And I think that's kind of problematic considering their colonial past. Why do you think France fails to recognize its racial diversity to this day? And do you think they're failing to recognize their colonial past because of that racial, because of that colorblind policy that they have currently?
That's a great question. So, you know, I think that I know more about the French policies towards religion, which are very similar to what you're describing, this sort of laïcité, which is to sort of, it's not the same idea of secularism in the US where you tolerate religions, it's really where you kind of keep it out, right? You keep it out, so that's why they have, you know, laws banning the hijab instead of saying, you know, whatever anybody wants to practice is fine with us. I think, yeah, maybe it is in some way, I mean, it's hard for me, I don't want to sound like a preachy American of like, here's how you really should reconcile things from your colonial past, but I remember when I was reading about the reactions of some of the people from Guadeloupe and Martinique when they would go to France, is that they you know, they got French citizenship, and this didn't mean that they were treated like a French citizen in France. You know, I remember there was a story of this one guy who was waiting in line at customs, and there was an official standing there saying, this is for French citizens, this is for French citizens, like yelling it in his face. And so he finally said, I'm from Martinique. And the guy said to him, yeah, the line for foreigners is over there. So like the own French official didn't realize that Martinique is part of France, you know, and he was only going off of race. So I think, you know, there's like any country like the United States, there's a lot more that has to be done to sort of reconcile that. But the French went in a way that, you know, has worked in the past, that I think assimilation has a long record of erasing differences by just ignoring the fact that they're there. It's different than a multicultural model. I'm not always sure that it's worse, but. Yes.
Yeah, I really enjoyed this presentation because I think, you know, like you're hearing from the questions, it taps into a lot of the debates that are going on today. I had first a question about the first half of your presentation and then a question about the second half. The first question is motivated by the fact that the case selection of just looking at French colonies. So I'm wondering to what extent is the fact that these are French colonies explaining the push towards nationalism itself? So the adoption of rhetoric that's already tied up so much in what it means to be French and the identity of the national identity of being French. So the fact that, you know, when we think back on self-determination, how the French experience and the French Revolution influenced that. And so I'm wondering if, and I realize that there's not variation on that that variable itself because you're looking at all French colonies, but I wonder if you have variation to the extent to which different colonies internalize that model and that sense of being French, whether it was maybe differences in education. You know, I know that in a lot of these French colonies, right, that the model, and you'll probably have different variation by indirect versus direct rule, but I would expect that they're all getting the Bach, that they're all having the exact same education system. But I'm not sure if there's variation to the extent to which that's internalized. The second question that I had to do with the indirect rule, which that's why I was saying that this is tapping into a lot of debates today. So legal pluralism, for example, just thinking about, you know, how does that disrupt the distribution notion of foreign aid. There's a professor here, Janine Ubink, who's in the law school, and so she might be somebody whose work is interesting, since she does a lot on legal pluralism. But I'm wondering if, since the question that you're asking, if I understand correctly, is about variation, explained variation in the colonial powers' decision to do indirect versus direct rule. And I'm wondering if the decision to use indirect rule is motivated by looking for colonies that were already at risk, or that were at most at risk for resistance. So, you know, if you take indirect rule as a divide and conquer kind of approach, you know, and then choosing indirect rule because it's going to be most effective at quashing or stopping, preventing any kind of further resistance. Whereas maybe direct rule is used for those colonies that you're less worried about. Maybe there's more heterogeneity, ethnic heterogeneity, or less political mobilization to begin with.
Great, thanks a lot. Let me start with the last one, the indirect rule question. That, thanks for the suggestion. I need to think more about legal pluralism, because what I'm thinking about there is that when you try to have a customary law, you know, it's not that they just kind of left it alone, but a lot of times there were still attempts to codify or write down customary law. So my suspicion, or my going hypothesis going in, is that maybe some laws were decided were not allowed to be put into those books, and some were. So I'm very interested in which ones were included and why, and which ones were excluded. So we know that the French and the British changed laws everywhere because they outlawed slavery, for example. But they still allowed some practices to be ongoing. So I'm interested in which ones, and whether the things, according to what I'm suggesting, we might expect to see laws that would be that would allow more control or allow more flexibility of the kinds of responses you could use to rebellion to be left in place. So whether they're motivated, I don't know the answer to the other part of that question about what's the motivation. I don't feel like that's right, but I don't think I've done enough work yet to say that, because I think that, I think that indirect rule was often used later. First of all, it wasn't used for a whole colony, right? So it varied. But also, I think that part of the reason why it becomes more popular later on is because colonialism at the international level is becoming less popular. And it's harder to make the argument by the time you're getting later colonies in the early 20th century for this sort of civilizing mission. And so there's sort of we're coming in and it's going to be temporary, and there's the mandate system or these other kinds of systems. So that may be a reason. It would be hard to see why they'd be. But it's definitely worth, I'll have to think more about whether they're more at risk for resistance or not. In terms of what the French in the colonies might have internalized along the lines of what the nation meant, or what the French nation meant, I mean, I think it's important to recognize that, you know, by the end of the colonial period, primary education in French Africa and French North Africa was not very strong. Most people were not getting an education. So I don't think they were being inculcated at a mass level, mass education level, in a sort of, you know, French nationalist level. It was still something that was that elites would have access to, and that wasn't, you know, mass compulsory education. But, you know, at the same time, they still may have, you know, internalized a sort of model of nationalism. But I think the model that at least is reflected in elite writings is consistent with what I said, that being a French national or part of the French nation means that you're part of a republic. And a republic is a place in which there are certain kinds of rights. And that was something that was useful politically for those actors to focus on, because they didn't have those, and because they were trying to make that argument. And they did make the argument of, you know, we can be Muslims, but we could also be French without abandoning Islam. So they tried to alter what it meant to be a French national as well. Yes?
I'm wondering if it would be interesting in your studies to include the more subtle case of Corsica, mm-hmm. where nationalism is there and French governments have reacted in various ways.
Yeah, you know, I should do that, because I can't think of anything better than going and doing field research in Corsica. So. I don't know enough about it, but yeah. So there is, you know, there has been nationalism, and I don't want to say that just because you get integration, you're never going to get nationalism again. There's lots of cases of places that have full French full citizenship, not just in France, where so you can get nationalism through other pathways. You know, would you get Corsica leaving France? You know, I would need to think more about that. You know, or some people do, right? Yeah. Same thing with Quebec or something. So you can get it in a place where people have full political rights. But
some French ones have reacted very strongly, and then there was violence. And now they tend to give a little more freedom to people in Corsica.
You know, when I was at the very opening stages before the book came out, when I was still, you know, working on my prospectus as a graduate student, I had the list of French colonies that I had up here, and I put Corsica on it. And somebody in the room freaked out from France. They were like, you cannot go around with a list of colonies and have Corsica on it. Which just goes to show, you know, the way that we think about what it really is a core part of our country or isn't a core part of the country can be, you know, very constructed. You know, why should Corsica be seen that way but Martinique not be objectionable to include? It's, you know, interesting question. Yes?
I find this idea of using one's legitimacy towards a certain image or a person as leverage against them really interesting. Do you think this could be applied to other things, for example, popular culture today, or us as Americans or other countries? Because I feel like it could be developed into a theory or something like that.
What do you mean? Can you say more using the...
You mentioned that in indirect rule, you have the home country use indigenous ruler and their legitimacy to govern the people through by a satellite. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I feel like at its roots, there's this idea of using legitimacy as leverage, as a bad thing as opposed to a good thing, or, you know, against a people.
Yeah, I think that makes sense. I mean, I'm not sure, you know, since I'm only at the outset, whether I'd want to generalize beyond it, but I think you're right. And I mean, I guess I thought you were going to say that I think, I mean, these are both part of the ways that people struggle. So in the first part of the project that I had worked on, I look at, you know, the argument about rights and about people demanding rights was sort of the indigenous actors using France's own rhetoric against it, right? And that is very common. And that is very common to use the kinds of promises. You're supposed to be a republic. You're supposed to believe in equality, fraternity, and liberty, and you're not doing it. And I think that's a powerful mobilizing mechanism to point out hypocrisy that still gets used in all kinds of protest movements today. But on the other side, to sort of, you know, create legitimacy by delegating to actors without maybe making a meaningful change, I don't know, that could almost be applied to university administration, but I shouldn't. Luckily, I'm not in this one, so I don't. Yeah, I mean, I think it could be applied to other situations. Come on.
Yeah. I have one question on sources. Mm-hmm. So we often see when occupying powers are hurrying back, their occupation is ending, they're burning some of the most consequential documents mm-hmm. to their rule. We see these pictures all the time. And so in some senses, do you think you're getting a very select view of the French occupation of Morocco or Algeria? And in terms of that the most vicious documents are already burnt out and eliminated, and that there might be officers who might want to give a certain picture of how their rule was, so perhaps some of the most contested documents are already burnt out or deleted, or whatever. That might influence some of the outcome, or getting access to them might just not be possible, and, you know.
So when I started this project, it was because I was interested in authoritarian rule. And I thought I was going to do a project on authoritarian rule in contemporary Morocco or contemporary Tunisia, but it's so hard to get access. You can't get access to those documents. You know, you can never get access to a contemporary authoritarian regime. That's really hard to get. So the great thing about the French is that, you know, they're a democracy at home. They were an authoritarian regime in Algeria, in Vietnam, and so we can go and get the access to the archives, and we can use, you know, the French equivalent of the Freedom of Information Act to read what they wrote. So, but then there's a question of, you know, as you're saying, is this just a subset? So we can get a lot more than we can from a contemporary authoritarian regime in the Middle East. But is there a sort of subset? Certainly when I was doing research at the archives of the armed forces in France, sometimes I had this horrible situation where I would ask for a carton, and then you could only request three per day, and then they would come back to me and tell me, I'm sorry, that carton is still classified. And they were usually on Algeria. And then I would say, okay, can I have a list of the cartons that are classified so I don't waste my time asking for them? And she told me the list of the classified cartons was also classified. So I was, you know, I was like crazy to do research. I'm like, I don't know what so, you know, certainly there were things that were being withheld. And after I did this research, subsequently they released more stuff on Algeria, specifically on the Algerian War. One thing, though, that I found that I was really surprised about in the French documents was how frank they were about their use of repression against Moroccan actors. Sometimes they sounded almost proud of it. You know, they would say, and these were, the documents I used, they were classified at the time. So they weren't written for an outside audience. They would say, these people came out into the street, we shut that down, and it was awesome. And they, you know, I mean, that's not the literal translation, but they sounded very proud of it. And I was really surprised at that. What I really think you can't use them for, though, is to judge the sort of state of mind of people in Morocco or Algeria. They didn't understand that. They didn't have good access. So you can't get a good sense of public opinion. The documents tended to say, everybody loves us, or something bad would happen, and they would say, you know, oh no, they're all against us. And they went back and forth between these two poles. So they're not a good way of judging that.
Not going for regime change, right? If you're saying there are human rights abuses that have to be dealt with, you know, but neither of these two strategies seem to be working in terms of putting a new regime in place.
I guess the one thing, I mean, you're not going to like this because you tried to exclude my answer already, but the one thing I would say is that, you know, the French and the British invested enormous resources in their colonies, and they went there for a long time. You know, they stayed 130 years in Algeria. And even after 130 years, you know, they still made tons of mistakes. And they still, you know, we tend to think, looking back on the colonial period, of the British and the French as being able to divide and rule very deliberately and manipulate different actors. But when you look at their reports, the level of information they have, you know, problems with language and communication, it's not that high. So what does that tell me when the United States wants to have an occupation in some place that it has almost no experience in and very few officers trained in the native language? Like, it doesn't make me very hopeful that there's not going to be lots of unintended consequences, even when we go in with the very best of intentions. So I guess, you know, I've sort of moved in my position towards even helping with human rights, even sometimes something as, you know, as easy as doing, you know, vaccinations can go, as a colleague of mine in public health was telling me, can go terribly awry when you're not aware of the context and the actors that you're dealing with.
On that note, please join me in thanking Mr. Lawrence.